talk today is work that was done in collaboration with David Chernoff at Cornell. Okay, so there are three broad classes. So we have heard there's a whole lot of data that's going to come up in the next decade, and we need good theoretical models, accurate theoretical models to match the data. And so there are three broad classes of tools. One is numerical simulations. These are almost exact, but their two main drawbacks is that they're time consuming, but more importantly, they are short noise limited. That is, they use a discrete representation for the density. And so for things like non-Gaussianity that was talked earlier, these could pose limitations. The other class is perturbation theories, either in the Eulerian frame, that's EPT, or in the Lagrangian frame, that's LPT. The advantages are that they have a smooth description of the density and velocity fields, but their higher orders are cumbersome and they also suffer from convergence issues. And the third thing, I hope you can read this, third way is you restrict your system to simple geometries like spherical or ellipsoidal collapse. The advantages here is that the system reduces to just second order differential equations, which can be then coupled to semi-analytic schemes like excursion sets and so on. But the problem is that these are often non-local and there's no mode coupling, which is an important feature of non-linearity. And these arrows here indicate that you can mix and match depending on the application, these three broad class of tools. The talk today will focus on perturbation theory in the Lagrangian frame, and in particular, I'll talk about some of these convergence problems. So what is Lagrangian perturbation theory? The main variable of interest is the displacement. So the physical position r is expanded around the expanding background, and the only force is Newton's law of gravity. So S is the main quantity of interest. You put this back into the equation and solve perturbatively. The density is computed from the volume transformation between the initial coordinate space and the final coordinate space. And because when two particle trajectories cross, the volume element formally becomes zero and the density effectively diverges. And that's when Lagrangian perturbation theory breaks down. So this is the well-known shell crossing regime. The other problem, which is perhaps not so much focused on, is that Lagrangian perturbation theory does not converge in spherical voids. So these are, if you apply it to a void solution where there is no future physical singularity, even then you can see, so this is B is the scale factor of the expanding void, you go up to 15th order and you still don't see convergence. The series is convergent only up to a scale factor of about 0.2. So I'll first talk about this problem, which is the lack of convergence in voids. And this was work done that was a little while ago, so some of you have already seen it, and I'll come back to the shell crossing problem later on. And few other people have talked about this, but as I said, this is not much talked about in the literature. So the physical problem is that of the spherical top hat. You have a spherical over or under density, and it's characterized by two initial conditions. One is the over density delta, and the other is the peculiar velocity, which is delta V, is just the ratio of the Hubble parameters. And you can think of the capital delta, which is the magnitude of the perturbation, and this little delta is, if you wish, the strength of the two, which is more important, density or peculiar velocity. The Zeldovich approximation is a very specific relation between delta and delta V, corresponds to minus one-third. Delta V is minus one-third delta. And the idea is that you know for this system the exact solution. You can solve it analytically for the Einstein D sitter omega m equals one cosmology. And you can also expand it in terms of this parameter delta I, delta raised to I is a series. And to understand the convergence, what you need to do is you need to treat delta as a complex variable and locate the singularities of this exact solution in the complex delta plane. So given an initial delta, the time of validity is the time a singularity first occurs in this complex delta plane. So here is this what we call the root plot. This is the radius of, so conversely, given a time interval, the radius of convergence is the initial range of values that you can use to do, I mean, that for which the perturbation series is valid. So you can just read off the time of validity given an initial delta and theta. So based on this, we could explain the open model. So this is a case with model parameters delta of 0.01 and theta is 2.82. This is corresponds to a void with zero which initial velocities. And here, from the root plot, you can just read off the time of validity is a of 0.179, which is approximately what is observed. In addition to this, we found that not all closed models are convergent, but indeed, the closed models which obey Zeldovich initial conditions are valid until collapse, which is why, you know, one LPT and two LPT work so well because of this. Otherwise, we would have seen signatures of that earlier. So how do we fix this problem? The idea is analogous to analytic continuation. So you say that given an initial delta and theta, you propagate the system till the time of validity. You read off the new initial conditions, read off your new initial delta and theta, and keep taking steps. So you treat LPT as a finite difference scheme, not as a single step scheme. And the question is, does this LPT re-expansion actually allow you to overcome the shell, not the shell crossing, but the convergence problems? It does. If you look at, you can understand by examining this phase plot, where this is delta and delta V. So this is how the dynamics looks in phase space. And it turns out that all the void models actually just converge to a point. So delta goes to minus one and delta V goes to minus 0.5 or 3 by theta, which is a velocity divergence, is just 3 by 2 for the Einstein de Sitter case. So this is just a constant, and h of t always decreases, and therefore the time of validity when you do this re-expansion always increases. So that you can formally prove that this increases, and you can, the scheme is demonstrated here. You take a single step, you don't have convergence, three steps and five steps, the errors go down significantly. The next thing was to consider, apply the scheme to generic three-dimensional initial conditions, so in a grid. Here, the idea for time stepping is simple. You calculate the time of validity for each grid point and take a conservative time steps that satisfies over the whole grid. But that's not enough. So there was one other detail that is missed. And you can understand that by going, so the equations for the displacement are the just the Newton's laws. But in this formal LPT framework, which was laid down by Bukert and Ehlers in 93 and 97, and also Bukert initially did it in first for one LPT, two LPT, and so on, it involves taking the divergence and curl of this equation, and these spatial derivatives kill any time component in your, so I think there is a, this is probably something left off here, but there's a delta t, oh yeah, that's here. There's a extra time dependent piece, which we call the frame shift, which if you don't include, it actually breaks momentum conservation. So this is an one-dimensional example of that. So it's well known that LPT is exact in 1D. But so you can apply this, that exact, to that example, you can apply this iterative scheme. You should get the same answer no matter how many steps you take. But if you take more number of steps and don't include frame shifts, you actually get an error. And if you include the frame shifts properly, this is within, I mean, this is a numerical 10 raised to minus 16. So the idea, the main point here is that for a single step LPT, these frame shifts are not important if you start with Zeldovich initial conditions. But for a multiple step scheme, you do need to account this extra. So this is like a gauge degree of freedom, if you wish. And you do need to account for these gauge degree of freedom. So to conclude, this is the LPT re-expansion scheme is a scheme that deals with smooth fields not limited by short noise. It is capable of handling generic initial conditions. So the scheme we had, we allowed for velocities that were not Zeldovich, as well as the as well as transverse components of the velocity field were allowed. And you have error control with three parameters. One is the grid size ns, the second is the Lagrangian order n, and the number of steps nt, and the error is exponential with ns, exponential with Lagrangian order, and algebraic convergence in nt. And the fine print here is all of this is valid up to shell crossing. So that's the thing I'm, this is now still work in preparation, but we have started to address this issue. And this is an issue that has been looked by many, many more people. I have just listed a few of them here. So the main point is that once you have shell crossing, the Euler-Poisson system also breaks down. It's not just that the system breaks down in the Lagrangian frame because of this volume transformation, but actually the Euler-Poisson system is not valid in the multi-streaming regime. And so to the small-scale crossings, the small-scale physics actually comes back and affects your large-scale physics. And so you can't just say that let me get rid of the small scales and just apply LPT to large scales, because in the shell crossing regime, the equations are wrong. So the correct equations were formulated by this effective field theory, which was in the early, from 2010 to 2014, I think there were a lot of papers on this. And so what they have done is they have effectively given you what is the effective, so the small scale streaming gives you an effective pressure term, an effective shear viscosity, and an effective bulk viscosity, and they predict the form of this stress tensor. And how do you couple this to this re-expansion scheme? And so the method we use is that of operator splitting. So the idea is that you solve the non-viscous part using LPT, LPT re-expansions also, and I mean depending on whether how close you are to shell crossing, and then you update the velocities just using the viscous acceleration. So you ignore this, solve this system just in the Lagrangian frame, and then you include this. The density stains are unchanged, you just do a velocity update. And so this turns out to be a hybrid Eulerian-Lagrangian scheme. It's no longer just a LPT scheme, but you can do this sequentially. You take one step in LPT, update it in the Eulerian frame, reinitialize your conditions, and take another LPT step, and then again an Eulerian step, and so on. And here is so we tested this, or we are in the process of, I mean, this is still work in preparation, testing it on a spherical system. So we start with initial conditions that are Fillmore, and sorry, this is a typo, it should be Goldrick. 1994, they did the whole, they had a self-similar model of cold dark matter collapse. And you evolve this solution, so it's a time-varying radial, I'm sorry, this is a radially varying spherical profile. You evolve it from A from 0.001001 to 0.5. And here is the, this is the plot for Einstein de Sitter. This red line here is what you would have if you didn't have any viscosity. So the inner shells would just collapse into a black hole and that's it. But when you include the viscosity, the core actually stabilizes. The density for C nu is 20. So C nu is just a parameter that controls the viscous terms. Right now I've assumed them all to be equal. And if you increase that C nu, the velocity is the core density is lower, which is expected. And this is for lambda CDM. Again, the core density is lower than that of that for the Einstein de Sitter. And so in both these cases, you can get the core to stabilize. So this is the implementation in the re-expansion framework, but you can also ask, suppose you were to just do a single step LPT calculation, which is what is most, applicable, using viscosity. So it turns out that the displacement can no longer, in this case, be written as just your growth factor times the potential. But in fact, it's a little more complicated because, so if you didn't have these terms, you could do that, but these Laplacian derivatives here actually give you a k dependence. So in principle, so still, this is all work very much in progress, but this is one of the master's thesis students in IIT Kanpur just tried out this stuff. So here is the case where you put, this is linear growth without, just the linear growth. This is LPT with pressure and LPT without pressure. So you can see that for a single sine mode, you can get the high density to be lower. So I should say that this scheme does not prevent shell crossing. It could only delay it. It is still within the Zeldovich framework, so it won't prevent shell crossing. And some of these calculations were kind of done applied to the Navier-Stokes in a non-cosmological context in a recent paper. So I think to conclude, the long-term goal is to provide a short noise-free numerical scheme capable of tracking nonlinear evolution from early epochs to today, and whose error can be fine-tuned depending on the application. And the application I currently have in mind is the SKA. Thank you.
Thank you.